The basic biology of humans predominates their behavior. If you look at the world of living beings, it is very much crafted in the nature of sex. For no reproduction is possible without sexual intercourse in non-asexual living beings. In species where sexual dimorphism exists, lust is part and parcel of how to execute sexual action. And people are not oblivious to it. Sex and lust are an integral part of life. Maybe not for Jesus and his followers who left their homes, or millions of monks who leave their homes in different religious traditions, but for all those who don't. So people cannot attack sex or what is the object of sex. Yet they must ensure sexual morality remains present in some form in the society. I once had a discussion about lust among Christians. Lust is one of the major sins in Christianity. And while it was condemned, it could never be condemned wholly, because to condemn it wholly means to condemn propagation of new life altogether. Men need to be seduced, some way or the other, for that to happen. So men need to capitulate to their lustful instincts. But they also need to restrain their lust. The best way is pretty obvious. One could not throw away the object of desire, for then there would be no desire to begin with. But one could punish the subject for having been consumed by desire at inappropriate times. No wonder in the West there is no dearth of sexual material which you could lust over. And still, there is no dearth of complaining about men lusting. In fact, in this sense, West is a giant whorehouse where you do not pick the whores, but the whores pick you. It is still not free, and you could still be penalized if you are too vocal against the system or the whores. In nutshell, it is Satan's paradise. But how do people manage it? How are they able to promote sex and then criticize people choosing it? Of course, they must feel it weird that somehow their society stands for both sexual expression and desexualization. But what they would do then? They want to have sexual pleasure, and they want to have a stable society too. They also want to jerk off to how sexually moral they are. They want people of other cultures to not think of their women as sluts, like Muslims or Indians. But they also want their women to have full freedom to be sluts. However, it is not just a Western behavior. Here, let us try using our brains and intellect to understand the views of a very popular Hindu guru, Sadhguru, about sexual degeneracy in the world. Sadhguru tells us a heartwarming and heart-wrenching story of a popular musician who in this perverted world of males cannot help but not expose herself. One gets teary-eyed thinking of the fate of such women who have to submit to the perversion of men, who often act like animals. Let us listen to him.
Because I was supposed to talk to some musician, and I said, okay, let me hear something. So they played a video. I'm sorry I'm using such words, but I'm saying because it pains me that women are being projected like this. And a musician is on stage in underpants. I said, why are musicians in underpants? They said, Sadhguru, only that sells. I said, what is this? So this is horrible exploitation of the woman, and women are cooperating in this. She can wear what she wants, it's not my business. But if she's wearing that only because that's what sells, that is not right in the society. It's her choice what she wants to wear. But it's not her choice, somebody else is determining her choice, which is not choice at all. So this is important both for young boys and girls, they need to come up with this, that your body is your business, all right? It is not something that everybody needs to be involved with your body on the street.
Sadhguru knows how stupid it is for women to use sex while singing to promote themselves. But he is a man, he knows what it is for. But he could not dare criticize women, for if he does so, even though he is supposed to be an enlightened being, society will eat him alive for both disrespecting women, who many Hindus believe to be literal goddesses, and Sims believe to be literal princesses, and for attacking the object of sexual impulse. So he turns his attention to criticize male lust, because women already shame males' lust to control them. And Men do not care about male lusting as much as they care about scantily clad women. It is a perfect combination, but the standard he sets is illuminating nevertheless. While women choosing to be scantily clad to promote their skills cannot be criticized directly, he argues that women do it because of male lust. If the males did not lust, the women would not feel any need to exploit it. It is because of male lust that women have to exploit their lust to make money. Of course, they could go on without doing it and earn less money, but why they should do that and act against their own interests? There is no denying that it is true that if women wore skimpy clothes and males still did not lust, women would not wear skimpy clothes. But the admission of that fact also forces one to admit that women use their bodies to seduce men, which is something that ancient texts also say. But the very same population finds it misogynistic because it makes women seem like prostitutes. Sadhguru says that it is the male perversion that is determining what women choose to wear, rather than them making their choice freely. Because the world created by men for women is fake anyways, and not subject to reality. Free choice for women in this ideal world does not just mean free in the sense of not being forced to do something, but free in the sense of having a decision that is free in its fullest sense. That is, even though women are trying to earn money by exploiting male lust, they are able to exploit that lust without even trying as much as to at least look a little bit attractive. It is a precursor to demanding fat female models on the salacious magazine covers. This is not it. Of course, it is hard to imagine that men and women do not know that women do not just dress sexy even in normal life. You could see women trying to get attention even in public places. That is not the problem. The problem is not women trying to get male attention. That is a good thing. The problem is males giving them attention. But how you can have one without the other? How would women attain attention without males giving them attention? What is going on? Sex is a tool devised by nature to extract money and resources from men. It is a tool by which women increase their value and make up for what they lack in other areas. That is why no matter the field where women are present, sexuality finds its way. As women try to look good to gain extra adoration, conservative, liberal, does not matter. Of course, if people criticize women who are engaging in this soft prostitution, they would have to criticize sex. It is like if you criticize alcohol, you criticize all of the intoxication associated with it. But if you criticize people who just cannot handle the alcohol, you can have as much alcohol as you want, but still punish the weak people who abuse it. Similarly, if you criticize female sexuality, you give up all of that. Not even the most traditional men want to do that because they have their wives and they would have daughters who they would want to be attractive to make up the difference in the male-dominated world. So, the best strategy is to attack male sexual instinct for all of them. So if you see a woman twerking on the street and criticize her, you criticize the object of sex. But if you somehow argue that all males watching her need to be in their limits, you could enjoy the twerking and still be moral in the eyes of people and yourself. Now of course, you cannot go to the extent to make it obvious, but you can slowly play the game. Contrast this with monks. Monks do not want to play the game any bit. So they do not hang posters of sexy females in their monasteries and then implore other monks to control their lustful thoughts. Just like they do not open bars in the monasteries and then ask monks to remain dry. And of course, because the whole idea is to preserve maximum pleasure while enforcing maximum morality, the more hedonistic it gets, the more orgasmic it is for sexually moral people. More is the proverbial pawn in the society, more you can enforce the sexual morality among men. Because of course, how good is a man who does not have sexual thoughts while seeing a woman in the burqa? It would be so good if males could stop having sexual thoughts when women all around them are wearing as provocative clothes as possible. The more provocative a dress a woman wears, the more respect you need to provide her to make her not seem an object, and the more you can then jerk off your moral instincts. And best of all, you still retain all the sex. But of course, it is reserved for women primarily. If you as a man dress sexually, you would be labeled gay and be mocked by the good people. The reason why so-called good people, aka normies, think males who show off their bodies like women are gay is because they know that self-sexualization is for women. Of course, it is the women who have the privilege to apply makeup and make their lips look attractive. It is the females who can wear see-through clothing, who can wear miniskirts, who can wear heels and tight leggings, because it is about sex. But get them to admit it, and they won't. They don't want to make women appear like sluts, because they know that is what all women do, in some degree or the other. None will be saved under this principle. Let us look at another example of the deceptive nature of sex to complement this discussion.
How, when you're a model, like how brazenly are people hitting on you and how disgusting is it? Is it like in movies?
Trying to think. I don't know if I was just, I was really standoffish.
Okay.
Okay. My gamer tag was Bane of Man. So my joy in life was shooting douchebags down, just shooting them down. So the guy would come up to me and I'm like, I'm not meeting my husband in a New York bar. I'm Bleecker. I'm very sorry. Goodbye.
Oh.
Yeah. Oof. I just didn't want to
talk because, Maiden.
Yeah, well, they didn't want a relationship. They're like, hey, can I put my wiener in you? And I was like, not interested. Like, cause that's, I'm not that girl. Like, I've never done a one night stand. I never will. I'm not, I don't know you. I'm not comfortable with you. I'm going to sit on some weirdo's face. Like, get out of my life. Like, I just do not know who you are and if you're going to kill me. So that has always been my thing. So yeah, it was very dismissive. And then usually if like a nerdy guy or someone with some intellect would talk to me, then I would open up. But if it was like, yo, I'm a bridge and tunnel boy, girl, what's up? I'm like, get out of here.
The guy asks a very simple question. In this sexually liberal world, he wants to know whether men hitting on women to get laid is as disgusting as it is in the movies. The funny thing is, he is talking to a model whose job is sexual in effect, replies how she loves shooting douchebags who are men, who just want to put their wiener in. She frames an example that would appear very disgusting and humiliating for men. That is, her putting her butt on their face. The guy being smothered by her butt is a weirdo for having this weird fetish. Does wanting consensual sex and nothing else makes you a douchebag? Is there any act of sex that is not disgusting? The power that women enjoy over men in this regard arises from degeneracy. That is why males can be shamed for it. That, however, is the very thing used to uplift women, even models, whose tricks of trade depend ultimately on seduction and attraction. She can call men douchebags and weirdos without worries because she enjoys a privileged place, thanks to her coochies. In this sense, sex is unlike any other desire. It seeks validation from disgust, and it uses the disgust itself to attain power. What is most lovely is most degenerate, and that is the deception of sex. It appears to be for men and by women, but in reality, it is justified by being for the women and by the men. It is a tool for controlling male instinct for the sake of women, and everyone is on it. No wonder it is promoted and demoted at the same time. That is how the whorehouse maintains its value, while maintaining its appeal. If you do not shame the buyers, you cannot afford to get large payments. If you leave the trade, you do not get it at all. The basic biological instinct is indeed correct.